Pleasure to welcome you all to the 16th edition of India Digital Summit, Supercharging Startups, organized by Internet and Mobile Association of India. This summit is supported by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Government of India, and Niti Aayog. I'm your host for the session, Manmeet from IIM. Welcome to the Fireside Chat on Blitzscaling BNPL for Bharat. We would like to thank our Digital Financial Management Partner, EaseBus, Conversational Messaging Partner, Gupshop, Session Partner, Mobikwik, Gold Partners, Manorama Online, Bling Digital and Yellow.ai, Silver Partner, ShareChat. Without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Ms. Bhawna Sangwan, Director and Associate General Counsel, Payments and Privacy, Amazon, who will be moderating today's discussion, and Ms. Upasana Taku, Co-Founder and COO, Mobikwik. I would request all the delegates to keep posting their questions in the chat box, and the panel will address a selected few at the end of the session. Over to you, Ms. Sangwan.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bhawna Sangwan, and I am Director and Associate General Counsel at Amazon Pay. It's absolute pleasure to be talking to you today. We have an indeed fabulous guest. I'm obviously extremely excited to host one of India's great fintech co-founder and CEO, Upasana Taku. Upasana, welcome to this session. It's real joy to have you today here.
Thank you, Bhawna, and thank you, IMAI, for having me here.
Upasana had a stellar career across the globe. She did her schooling in Surat and then went on to study engineering in National Institution of Technology in Jalandhar. She then completed her MS from Stanford University in US, and she began her career with HSBC in San Diego and then moved to PayPal in United States. She is India's first woman entrepreneur to lead payments business in India. Her story is really fascinating. If given a chance, I would like to devote this entire session to it. However, we have a plan for this conversation, and I will try my best to keep it. In today's session, we are really going to uncover a relatively new payments method, which has taken the fintech sector by storm and has caught the attention of many investors. It is one of the fastest growing fintech offering. The topic for today's talk is Buy Now, Pay Later, BNPL, as we call it. BNPL is a short-term financing that allows the customer to make purchase and pay for them in a future date. It leads to an instant customer gratification with a staggered plan of payment. Moreover, Buy Now, Pay Later does not charge interest, and it is also free from a cumbersome process of documentation as the customer has to go through while getting a line of credit or a traditional credit card. In this session, we will get insight from Upasana on various aspects of BNPL and how she sees this growing. But before we deep dive into BNPL, I would like to take opportunity to get a glimpse from Upasana's journey. You know, I think it's a fabulous story. So we would love to hear briefly about your upbringing, Upasana, your journey to co-founding Mobikwik.
Well, my journey is a fairly modest background. Both my parents, teachers, father was a physics professor, mom teaching music. While growing up, it was a simple middle class upbringing, a lot of focus on education. And as it's the case for most Kashmiri Pandit families, education is everything. So, bachchon ko padhane ke liye, they will send them to anywhere in the world to get them the best education. So a lot of focus on that. And of course, focus that, we are two sisters. So there was focus that you have to build a career for yourself. There was no question of, just getting an education and getting married and becoming a housewife. That was never on the cards. I think the conviction my parents had that, I should, touch, the boundaries and achieve as much as possible was also made, via circumstances. So I actually wanted to become a doctor, and I could not get into one of the good medical schools. And then I refused to go for, some of the, dental and other options I had. So I went to pursue industrial engineering in Jalandhar, post which I really wanted to get a master's degree. And I underline that because that was really sort of the defining moment. I had several full scholarship options, like at Purdue, Penn State. I had 3-4 admissions. And at Stanford for my MS, I did not have a scholarship at all. And as you know, it is a private university and by far one of the most expensive. And I can tell you, the entire savings of my family at the time, you know, they came down to about 6-7 lakh rupees, which was $10,000, which would have paid for one quarter of fees only. So there was no question of going there. And thankfully, you know, my sister encouraged me and I ended up going to the university 1 month before it began. And the game plan was very simple. Go there, market yourself, get a full scholarship. If you get a full scholarship, then you study at Stanford. Otherwise, you just fly to Purdue or Penn State and, you know, you study there. So that was sort of the big gamble. And I must tell you, those were my first lessons in door-to-door marketing myself to the different labs and professors at Stanford. And by the end of 29 days, at the 30th day, I finally got a full scholarship, which amounted to $100,000, which paid for my entire education for 2 years, as well as living expenses. So that was sort of my first self-belief in myself. And I know I'm talking about in great detail, but I'll just highlight that, you know, one of the key things as part of our education system, and especially for women, that we highlight on is bookish education, your grades, your GPA. But all of that actually doesn't matter in the end. When you're trying to build something as a professional or as a founder or a leader in a company, ultimately it boils down to your commonsensical thought process and your confidence in being able to implement that change, in executing that action. And that confidence, I believe, you know, in most, you know, Indians at those levels, you know, is not as much. I mean, I have seen today the level of confidence and the exposure people are getting through to internet is much stronger. But I can tell you, 20 years ago, I did not have the conviction to start up at 25 or 22. And there are you know, Indians who are dropping out of Stanford and, you know, starting startups at the age of 19 or 20 these days. So that's great. So, you know, education and that confidence in yourself that you can bring upon a change, I think that's very important. And, you know, I would encourage people to get as much exposure via education as well as via work that brings them that confidence that they can achieve whatever they want in their life.
Fantastic, Upasana. I think this is indeed inspiring and very motivating to know. So big shout to every woman out there to have courage and follow your dream. I think is a larger message that I would give. And we have a live example right in front of us. Nothing is impossible. It's just to come out of the comfort zone and have that kind of conviction. So thank you very much, Upasana. And I think, you know, the impact that you have created in terms of payments in India is also very remarkable, right? You built Mobikwik as one of the largest mobile wallet company in India with over more than 100 million users, 300 plus million merchants, and 200 billers on your platform. While the debit product and associated payments have seen a widespread adoption, you know, what are your thought process on the credit products? You know, why, what motivates Mobikwik to place a bet on buy now, pay later?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. And I want to explain it also for the sake of our audience members. See, when we started Mobikwik, you know, India had one of the most pathetic percentages of digitally transacting Indians, right? Most people were paying with cash. And in fact, people laughed at us that you were starting a digital wallet, mobile wallet. Why are you starting? I mean, think about 2009, right? No smartphones. Internet was also available only to the privileged, so to speak. Today, you know, we are in a situation where about 250 to 300 million Indians transact using digital payments on a daily life basis, you know, whether they are using wallet or payment apps or cards or what have you. Now, so that's a very strong growth that has happened. And in the upcoming next 5 to 10 years, I expect this number is going to even solidify further. I won't be surprised if India has 700 million digitally transacting users by 2026. Now, in contrast to that, today also, if you think about it, only 35 million Indians have a credit card. Although there are 50 million cards in force, 50, 55 million, they are actually issued to only 35 million Indians. Some of us have two. Now, that is abysmal. So that's again 3.5% of the population in India has access to a daily life credit product. Now, if you think about other credit products, right? So there is a consumer durable loan, there is a vehicle loan, there is a home loan, personal loan. Even if you add up all of that, best estimates show that 60 to 70 million Indians have access to credit if you add all of these products. So even that is only 6 to 7% of India. And that number is still very, very poor, even in contrast to the 300 million transacting users that we have. So there's a wide gap. People are transacting, but they're transacting with money, their hard-earned money, their savings, and they have no access to daily life credit. And I think that's where I think this gap is already very large. Next 5 years, if we have 700 million digitally transacting users, and let's say people who have access to credit goes from this number to, let's say, 100 million or even 120 million, even if it doubles, 60 or 120 million. Even that means that at least 500 million Indians will be transacting online. So they are leaving a digital footprint. They're transacting every day. But on one rainy day, let's say, you know, let's say today I am a professional and I earn 40,000-50,000 rupees. Let's say 50,000 rupees is my salary, monthly salary, right? I work in some company. Now, all of a sudden, you know, there is a lot of COVID going on right now, the third wave or whatever you may want to call it. Let's say 2-3 members in my family fall sick, right? I will be having to incur quite a lot of medical expenses. And if I don't have insurance for everybody in my family, or even if it is just to buy medicines, you know, my bill is going to go through the roof for this month because it's all going to be in a short period of time. And I don't have access to any credit product. So I'm going to either deplete all of my running savings or I'm going to have to borrow money from friends or family, right? Now, that is the problem we want to solve. I'm saying that, okay, digital payments, may we have made progress, we'll continue to make progress, and that number will grow organically as smartphones and internet in India grows. But what about credit and who's solving it? And why shouldn't an average Indian who earns, average Indians outside of the top 100 million Indians, they don't earn 1 lakh rupees per month in salary. They earn between 30 to 50,000 rupees per month in income, whether they are self-employed or salaried. And all of those users currently, if they go to their bank and they say, give me a credit card or give me a personal loan for 50,000 rupees or 20,000 rupees or even 10,000 rupees, they don't get it. It's not that they're not getting it because they're not credit worthy. If somebody is earning 50,000 rupees, they are definitely credit worthy to get a credit product up to 10,000 rupees. It's just that at those ticket sizes, unfortunately, our existing traditional financial institutions will not be able to give them a credit product because a 10,000 rupee loan for a bank is not going to be profitable. It's going to be significantly loss making. They will not make money. So therefore, they don't want to give it. A product which allows, or rather underwrites the user's own digital payment footprint and gives them a credit for that is what buy now pay later is. So as an example, if Bhawna, you have been a Mobikwik user, let's say for the last 6 to 12 months, and you've been transacting, let's say 4-5,000 rupees every single month, and whatever is your average or median spend for that entire duration, let's say it comes to 4,000 rupees, then Mobikwik will very willingly give you a buy now pay later line, which will be 6,000 rupees. So in a way, we are underwriting your own spend and just giving you a little bit more aspirational value on top of what you've been anyway spending with your own money. And the thought process there is, let's test these users by giving these credit lines. A credit line for somebody who's been spending 1500 could be 2500, somebody who's been spending 5000 could get 7500, something like that. And it's a simple 15-day product, so you can only use it for purchases, but you could purchase anything anywhere in India. You could use it for purchasing those medicines I was talking about. You could use it to pay an education fee, just to buy groceries, to order food, almost anything. So in a way, the buy now pay later service would work as your regular, kind of like your digital credit card, so to speak. And what it is doing is therefore it's building your credit history. You can repay it as a user. You can repay it on time, every time, and incur zero interest fee. But that one time period, let's say one 15-day period, when you really need working capital and you don't have access to any other credit product, That's when you use it and you say that, okay, this time I will not pay on time. I will pay 15 days later or 30 days later when I receive my next income stream. And for that time period, whatever days you are paying late, you will pay a late fee. So this is the way in which we want to bring access to credit to, you know, the next 500 million Indians who will be or are transacting digitally, but currently they are not getting served with any credit product.
Great insights, Upasana. I think very rightly you mentioned, you know, not more than 4% of the total Indian customers have access to actually the credit product. And it is interesting to note that India is also home for the second highest internet user and the telco user. India has also demonstrated its ability to transact into digital payments. The scale of digital retail payments that we have seen is unprecedented globally. However, the credit product is still underpenetrated. You know, if we take example of our rural India, you know, in spite of all the efforts to expand the rural credit structure, the volume of the rural credit in the country is still insufficient. The amount that is sanctioned is very, very limited. And also the customer has to go through a very cumbersome process of, you know, loan documentation and multiple follow-up and back and forth with the financial institutions. So at present, you know, this, so far the BNPL, the adoption is more concentrated in urban India, you know, based on the young generations who are transacting. What are your thoughts on how this will spread to rural India, the Bharat as we call it, you know, where exactly, you know, where even the financial institutions and banks are struggling to underwrite the loan? Also, how do you anticipate, you know, expanding BNPL from online to offline? What are the customer and merchant pain points that you think, you know, you will address in your journey at Mobikwik?
Okay, so quite a few loaded questions here. So let me set a little bit of context and then try to answer all of them. So you're right, rural India is still far behind. And I think they are far behind in the entire digitization of all their financial services. So payments is the starting, then comes credit, insurance, investment, all of that comes linked. So I think digital has to reach them more before we can make a larger dent there. And you rightly said that, you know, the focus of buy now, pay later is more urban. But I want to clarify something to you. Urban is not necessarily now Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, Calcutta. Urban, or rather cities, is now, you know, top 100, 200 cities and towns of India. So more and more on our platform, and, you know, I can only speak for the data I have ready access to, we are seeing more people trying to use services like Buy Now, Pay Later. Not as many people from the larger cities, but more and more people from, you know, Bhilai and Raipur and, you know, not as much as, you know, Allahabad, but sort of smaller cities. And the same thing happens to be the case all over India. You're just mentioning a few smaller cities for reference. And I think that this is something we need to understand. Like, if we think about India as like a billion people, there's obviously the top 100 million Indians who live in cities, and they are top by virtue of the earning potential that I'm referring to, where they make at least, you know, a lakh rupee in monthly income. And these are all people who are well banked and well served with the private banks of the country. So the, you know, Axis, ICICI, HDFC, Kotak, so on and so forth. Now, if you think from the rural India or from the bottom, you know, there is a large number of people, I would say 600 million people, that are at the bottom of the pyramid. Now, the between number, that is the 500, 600 million number that I'm talking about, these are not necessarily unbanked users. These are firstly banked users. They are residing in cities, towns, as well as villages of the country. But there are few things that help us identify them. Firstly, they have all, you know, involved internet into their daily lives, and they have access to internet, and they are using smartphones, and they're digital consumption is also fairly strong. So therefore, they are creating a footprint which was previously not available. Most of these users are all what you would call either new to credit or thin file customers, which means if you hit the the four credit bureaus in the country for any of these users, either you will not find a score for them because they've never taken credit, so there's no score, or you will find very little data. Maybe, you know, once they took some EMI loan to buy a television or a refrigerator, but the data is either old or very limited. Now, because of these reasons, traditional banks and NBFCs, are not capturing as much within this 500 million middle classes, which is what, I am referring when I say building for Bharat. This is what I'm referring to. I know there is another 600 million below that, but I think that we are still a little far away from capturing users like those. I think there is a lot happening for the lower 600 million by virtue of the government trying to get them via Aadhaar, via bringing more digitization into their basic banking infrastructure, via getting ATM machines to them. And I think it will take us a few years to bring them into the gamut. Currently, I think what most banks and NBFCs are focusing on is either the top 100 million or the top sliver of the middle class 500 million. If I think about most fintechs, actually most fintechs are also focusing on the top 100 million Indians. Why? Because their spending power is higher, their frequency of transacting is higher, and there is a lot of data available on them. And, unfortunately, for credit, you need data to underwrite. The differentiating thing that a payments platform like Mobikwik has, and I'm sure there are a few other internet companies who would have the same strategic advantages, is that you already have millions of users that are on your platform. They've already done KYC. So, for example, about 50 million Indians have done their KYC on the Mobikwik platform. And I'm sure similar large numbers with several other internet companies that are regulated and need to do KYC. Then these people have been transacting now for years. And that transaction data is a gold mine. And the only way to underwrite these users can be based on their own transaction data. Of course, the fact that they are using a smartphone also tells us a lot more about their, location, their overall earning and spending pattern, etc. But if you think from a building a digital credit product perspective, what are the things you need? You need users. And if somebody had to acquire 100 million users today, it will take them at least $1 billion to get that many number of users, right? So companies who have already acquired users have a leg up. Then if you have the KYC and the data of the user, so you are already ready for credit underwriting. And then if you are a payments platform, then you also have the merchants, which means you have a large bundle of use cases. And which is again a strength, because if I just created a new fintech today, a standalone fintech, if I acquired a few million users, then I would have to find a way, how do I give them credit which they can use? And it would be limited to the merchants I can get. By building on the payment rails that we've already created, today a Mobikwik user can use Mobikwik via, you asked about online, offline. A user can use it online, whether they are ordering medicines on PharmEasy or 1MG, or they're ordering groceries on Amazon Fresh or Big Basket, or they are ordering food from a Zomato or Swiggy. In all of these use cases and many more, they would be able to use a buy now, pay later line. Similarly, if they were to go offline to the nearby mother dairy or to the nearby petrol pump or the nearby departmental store, they would be able to use their BNPL by scanning the QR code, because Mobikwik has already built a large 3 million merchant base over the years for its payments business. And thirdly, and to ensure that the product can be used ubiquitously, I'm seeing a lot of fintechs doing this, and Mobikwik has also done the same thing, is that we also offer a card. So now the card can be used anywhere and everywhere in India, wherever cards are accepted, and the buy now pay later limit is available on the card as well. So these are the ways in which buy now pay later is now becoming a part of the digital lives of millions of people, and they can use it literally for online shopping or spends or bill payments. They can use it in the physical form factor, as well as any legitimate merchant that has any kind of digital payment acceptance. So today, I can tell you that from an industry perspective, a good at least 10 million people are using Buy Now Pay Later. Ourselves, we have pre-approved 24 million users for Buy Now Pay Later. And there are several other fintechs which have approved anywhere between 2 to 5 million users for their Buy Now Pay Later products as well. And then, of course, there are standalone platforms like Ola, like Amazon, like others who have also enabled Buy Now Pay Later for their own use case. So this industry is really scaling very rapidly. And I do believe that it will bring a lot of impact to the overall digitization of credit and financial services in India.
Fantastic. This is actually a phenomenal growth. You know, India is a relatively new entrance to Buy Now, Pay Later, but the early signal point to a future where it could be well become one of the largest BNPL market in the world. While COVID has definitely acted as a catalyst to Buy Now, Pay Later, but market dynamic clearly points to exponential growth of this trend. There is also a rise in the aspirational customer that leads to a sudden explosion of Buy Now, Pay Later. You know, on one hand, Buy Now, Pay Later is exploding due to the convenience that it offers to the customer. But it is also encouraging the young generation individuals to spend beyond their means. What are your thoughts on balancing these two factors? What are the, you know, what are the primary opportunities and challenges that you see as this country scale this product?
No, good question. And also, you know, the macro of our country is such that almost half of our country is less than 25, 26 years of age. So it is a country of young people, and young people typically aspire for a lot of new, materialistic products and services, and are also very open to experimenting with new products and services and seeing if they deliver on their value proposition. So you're right, as compared to other markets, like Western markets, Buy Now Pay Later is being offered, to already credit carded users. In India, we are offering it more and more to new to credit users. So that's a big difference. Now, when you spoke about people getting overextended, so I think that's where a little responsibility needs to be baked in to the different products that the fintech companies are building. So as an example, in our platform, we make sure we educate the user, because after all, many of these are people are experiencing credit for the first time. So we explain it via the product to them, that this is a free product for you, but if you go over the due timelines, then it will be a product that you will have to pay charges for. And so ultimately, we want them to think of it as a convenience product, but also it can be a credit product. So you have to be responsible in how to use it. So two parts are there. One is, how do you ensure the consumer is educated about paying it back and treating it responsibly within their means? The second is, what can companies do? And I think I have a strong opinion there. We are also, Mobikwik is also a member of Digital Lenders Association of India. And as part of that, I know various large and upcoming credible fintech companies, they are reporting all their products. Now, whether it is a cash loan or a personal loan or a Buy Now Pay Later loan, they are reporting all of it when the user takes the product to the bureaus. Which means that if the second fintech company wants to offer a loan to you, Bhawna, they would check the bureau and they will see that how many credit products, if any, do you have access to. And if you already have access to, let's say, if your earnings are 40,000 and if you already have access to between 5,000 to 10,000 credit product, then the second fintech company should ideally not offer you credit, because it's going to be very risky and is going to overextend you. So there is a little bit of responsibility here that I think that digital lenders also need to take, where many of us are doing it, but there are a few companies who are not taking this angle, responsibly. And if they do, then there will be no question of users getting overextended, right? If you don't report to the bureaus, then it is a problem. So if all fintechs who are very busy building and scaling digital lending in India, if we all start reporting every product, even if it is a convenience product, to the bureau, then it will ensure that every other fintech has full view of the user's open credit lines. And I think that is all that is needed. A little education and responsibility on the part of the user, and a little more on the part of the fintech player.
Fantastic. I think you will definitely leading to a more, you know, a phenomenal business on BNPL with a very ethical practice and adopting the standards that should work for the entire industry as well as for the customer. This is definitely a great combination of a young person having a great vision about looking at the things differently. This is actually taking me to the next question. And I believe that there are two sectors that exist today. The one is with regard to the traditional bank that are providing financing and the credit card. And the other is actually the fintech-led innovation like BNPL. The question is, can these two sectors coexist? And how does this drive your vision going forward for Mobikwik?
So definitely, I think they can coexist. I think like I explained right at the beginning that, you know, anywhere between 4 to 5% of India at the max has access to credit. So the pie is huge, right? There is 95% opportunity available to almost everyone to build products and get the customer onto that. So I think that from the perspective of digitization of processes and completely digital lending flows, I think in the past, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, you could have said that, you know, the banks and large NBFCs are, you know, a little behind the curve as compared to fintechs. But thanks to COVID, you know, in 2020 and 2021 with the first and second wave, as we have all seen, the digitization efforts of the banks, NBFCs have rapidly gone up. And as we speak, many of them are building their own fintech departments and teams because they realize the difference technology can make. Personally, I believe that the only way financial services is going to reach a billion Indians is via digital. There is no other way. There is no other distribution channel that is going to reach so many people over the course of the next decade. So I do believe that efforts are on from the existing financial institutions also to improve their digitization efforts. As they do that, that means they will be able to underwrite the users that they've already acquired for their banking products and offer them more financial products. You know, there is a lot that government-owned banks can do, by the way, where the delta between banked customers versus customers who have access to a credit product is significantly, you know, large. And I'm not saying that private banks have given it to all their customers, but the delta is even larger. I definitely think, just like in the payments world, we have seen similarly in the fintech and financial products world also, we will see coexistence. There is so much opportunity because of the strengths and the virtues. Banks will deliver and find success at a different spectrum of users and for different products. NBFCs will find their position for different products with different spectrum of users, and fintechs who can adapt much faster using technology will of course be at the forefront of expanding the entire, you know, credit pie. That is how I look at it. There is no question of competition when the market is so huge and open. That's how I look at it.
Thank you, Upasana, and a very fair perspective. I think that also gives a segue to the next question, which is, you know, the one of the main concern with the fintech-led BNPL is the rate at which it is growing, and also a risk of credit screening criteria for the customer before it is actually approved for BNPL product. While you definitely touched upon the credit score and the bureau check and the inputs that should be given by the industry, But this is also leading to some sort of a concern with the regulator. You know, the recent digital lending committee has actually raised concern and proposed a regulatory framework for regulating BNPL. Do you believe a formal regulatory framework for BNPL is required, or do you think the current light touch approach should be maintained in the current scenario where the country is?
This is a good, important discussion point, which has been getting discussed in the fintech circles and different industry bodies for the last couple of months. I think that there are two things that can be done here. One is that if you think about it, just like in the payment gateway business, you know, 10 years ago, there was a directive of self-regulation that these are the, there was no license. Of course, recently we have the PAPG license that has been, you know, started like a year ago, the licenses, as in the applications have been taken, right? But for a good 10 years, the sector was growing where there were directives which every entity had to self-apply to themselves if they were in this business. I think that in the fintech sector for digital credit and buy now pay later specifically, as you asked, there can be a set of rules that can be created and that every fintech that is participating has to follow. And those rules could be along the lines of, you know, fair practices, transparent and honest pricing to the users, and you know, how easily user concerns and grievances can be met. I think that predatory practices and all will already be taken care of there. I think most large fintech companies are anyways doing far more than what the sort of understood regulatory requirements that can be perceived. But I think there are, of course, much smaller and upcoming players who tend to not follow any such fair or sort of self-guiding principles because there are no principles published. So I think that should happen. A self-regulating entity should be created. And then from the perspective, what I understood from the working paper is there was a lot of question around liquidity and, you know, fintechs that are using the capital in partnership with banks and NBFCs and offering them loss guarantees. I think the way to regulate that is very easy. Since the NBFCs are already regulated entities, it is very easy to apply another sort of rule or condition on them saying that, you know, you cannot, you know, your fintech book or your digital book cannot be based on one player only. As an example, if you are an NBFC, let's say not no more than 10% or 20%, whatever can be the boundary condition of your digital book can be with one player. So that way there is some level of systemic risk which is getting distributed across several fintechs that they would have to, you know, partner with. And similarly, for that risk, the responsibility of ensuring that the partnering fintech has enough liquidity to support that, has enough collateral with them to support those guarantees. I think these conditions should be applied very easily to the already regulated bodies instead of creating a yet another regulation or license, because already we know we have somewhat 11, 12,000 or more NBFCs in the country. And if we don't create some such framework, then what will happen? All fintechs will apply for a NBFC license. And I'm not sure that will ultimately, you know, benefit the objective that either the regulator is trying to achieve, neither will it benefit the growth of the fintech sector or the consumer itself. So I'm just saying that there is a hybrid approach that can possibly ensure that more, you know, thorough processes are being applied across the board, across all fintechs.
Fantastic. Thank you very much for that insight, Upasana. I'll quickly move to one of the audience question, and that is, with the rise in BNPL, do you think we have also scaled, we have to also scale up our collection process, specifically in a remote location where it is more expensive for recovery?
Yeah, I think, of course, I think every fintech that is giving out money has to figure out a way to collect money. And I think that has to be the perspective from day one. It cannot be an afterthought. I know that there are several fintechs right now sitting on $100 million plus cash. And so perhaps are not focusing as much on collection. So I think that is sort of lesson number, point number one. Giving out money is always easy. But unfortunately, buy now, pay later or any credit product is not a cashback. So you need to collect it and therefore you need to build the collection framework from day zero. And I think the more, you know, fintechs will offer products to their existing users, that means that they will have more contact points or touch points with their users already. And, you know, for our use case, I can tell you our ticket sizes are so small, like they are in thousands of rupees, like I mentioned. So the best way to collect is digitally and via active engagement with the user. And for a very small percentage of users, do we actually end up doing even manual calls? A good percentage, even 95% of our users come to the app and pay themselves. And I think those kind of frameworks work for a smaller ticket size. For a higher ticket product, you know, where some people are doing 20, 30,000 rupee or even higher EMI based products, I do believe that there can be collection teams and strategies built out, both from a telecalling perspective as well as, you know, physical engagement perspective. And absolutely right. I mean, companies need to look at their P&L and see how are they going to collect the money. After all, it's, you know, convenience-backed credit and not a cashback. So collection has to be done.
I agree with that. Okay, I think we are left with last 4 minutes, and Upasana, I would like to use it to get some insight on your personal life. So I'm going to ask you a quick rapid fire round of questions, and you may feel free to just address in a one-liner response. So the first is that who has been your greatest inspiration?
Ooh, okay, that's a tough one. I think I get inspired by a lot of people, but yeah, I would say that my father has been a deep source of inspiration to me. He has gone through a lot of difficulties to achieve what he achieved in his life. So I'm trying to follow in his footsteps.
Fantastic. The second is, how many things you have purchased through BNPL?
Well, everything. I have a 15,000 rupee buy now pay later line on Mobikwik. So, you know, I'm buying. So every weekend I buy groceries from Amazon and Amazon Fresh. Then I order things for my kid from First Cry. Then I order, you know, everything in my house. Once on the weekend, we order from Zomato or Swiggy. So all of that, everything in my house happens on Mobikwik Zip, which is our buy now pay later product.
Fantastic. You know, if you could modify one aspect of your personality, what it would be?
Oh, one aspect of my personality. I think that I'm very, very passionate. So I do get caught up in the moment or caught up in a cause or get very empathetic to a person or a group of people and start supporting them. And sometimes, you know, I just I get very, very enthused and excited to getting the cause at hand to be done, whatever it is, whether it is a personal thing, a work thing, or even a philanthropic thing. Mm-hmm. And I think one thing I would like to change is that sometimes a little calmness and little waiting and patience is also helpful, because sometimes things do take time to happen and they don't happen right in the first time. So I think a little more patience. Yeah, patience. That's what I would like.
Fantastic. What is your most important learning from working remotely during COVID that you plan to use once the office reopens?
My most important learning is actually that work can happen remotely. Yeah. Because, you know, we've been working from the office for the last 12 years that we've been building the company. In the last 2 years, so 10 years we were working from office, and we always thought that remote teams is very hard, which is why we have very few remote employees. Only in sales, we have employees across India. Otherwise, everything from engineering to finance to marketing is all located in Gurgaon in our corporate office. And for me, it was a big learning that remotely we kaam ho sakta hai. So the entire, from March 2020 to Feb 2021, you know, those 10, 11 months of working remotely in the most difficult times for any company, and getting a full recovery in the business while getting and motivating people remotely. I think that for me was a big achievement. So it's a big eye-opener for me that once the world normalizes, I'm very excited that I'll be able to travel wherever I want to travel, and I'll still be able to work from there. So that's sort of my big goal and learning from this whole experiment. I did actually go to Tirthan, remote village in Tirthan in Himachal, towards the end of 2020, and then 2 months I rented a house there and I lived from there. Oh. And it was absolutely great. So that's a big thing for me, that remote is possible and you don't need to be jet setting on flights all the time.
Fantastic. And the last one is that if you had a magic wand and you can make one thing happen, what that would be?
The answer is very simple. I just would have a magic wand which gives us some booster shot so that this whole COVID, Omicron, Delta, we all become immune to it. And I just would like people to not fall sick and not, die. I think that's my big thing. I would just want to be done with this COVID, strains of COVID.
Thank you very much, Upasana. It has been a great session. I thoroughly enjoyed it. A lot of many great insight that came out. I am sure audience must have also enjoyed this session. We hope to see more of Mobikwik and more of Upasana as we progress in this year. Thank you so much for all your time.
Thank you. Thanks, Bhawna, for creating this very engaging session. I must tell you, I'm very happy about it because otherwise sometimes they can get like very boring and drab. So I'm very thankful to you for keeping it very peppy and energetic.
Thank you so much. My pleasure.
Thank you so much, Ms. Bhawna. Another thank you goes out to all our attendees who are here with us today. Stay tuned for the next session. Stay safe.
Thank you. Bye-bye.